Mini Chapter 4, Declaration of War by the Dreary Ones, Inciting Event. A month later, he has left the company, having spent the month conducting quiet investigations into the availability of various personnel he might hire in connection with his own games. The Bangdad bigwigs heard hints of these investigations, of course, via the industry grapevine, and before long, Jaymi learns on the same grapevine what a large and complexly shaped vacuum has been created by his own departure through the Dreary One's cocky underestimation of how much Jaymi himself enabled many of the processes and goodwill Bangdad depended on. Fragments of inside chatter reveal Dad and his cohorts to be nothing less than paranoid, indeed, concerning the danger of Jamie's leaking inside knowledge that could cast an embarrassing light on what a risk-averse, sheep-like flock of nervous Nellies they themselves are. Of comparable concern to these bigwigs is how he may compete with them, and what talent he may poach. Good. Let them fret. And may their corporate scale bog them down, too. For their hiring mindset is all geared towards giant development teams. Big AAA games like Bangdad's can take years to build. With dozens or hundreds of people working on them, it's no wonder individual creatives find themselves locked into narrow specialisms, where their input becomes like that of an assembly line worker installing the same components into a line of cars. Aside from the repetitiveness of this, it's not often possible for them to contribute much from their own creativity, which is often a motivation dampener. That's not how he'll be working. He will hire freelancers who have as little connection with Bangdad as he can arrange. He'll hire them at his own pace and in his own way, keeping them all as separate as possible from one another without jeopardizing the collaboration process, and having them work remotely. His reputation and the size of his contacts base will make this feasible. A non-standard approach for non-standard games. It'll be a pleasure to do things as he wishes. Thus will he walk with the angels, saying what he wants and nothing else, from Jaymi alone to the whole wide world. All right, to work now. Time for a brainstorm to help scare up inspiration and ideas for his own output, with which he'll knock 'em dead without a doubt. So he settles back at his desk and strikes out on a random, ragged romp through a score of websites, familiar and unfamiliar, all devoted to the independent games development community. Before long, down some online rabbit hole, he encounters a series of screenshots that someone has captured and preserved from a now-forgotten casual game released at least a couple of decades ago when he was a child. It seems the game was themed around an electronic band from that era, whose handful of musical hits exploded with a brief but global convulsion of excitement and innovation, such that almost anyone in the Western world who was around then would still recall their sound, he should think. How cutely old school this little game's interface looks now, although he can see that, in technical terms, it was quite respectable in the context of its era and budget. It's clear the game was created in genuine homage to the massive pop cultural furore achieved by the band in question, as well as in order to cash in on the furore, of course. Jaymi looks up from the screen captures and gazes through the window beyond the monitor, suffused with a sense of wistful sweetness at catching so vivid a glimpse down the corridor of time from the present to those distant-seeming flickers of games culture lying back there half-buried in recent history, in all their earnest humorousness of obliquity to the main thrust of that musical phenomenon, fluttering along in the wake of a sound that still echoes on down through the years in the memories of millions. His 1,000-meter stare through the study window is punctured by a dark speck hovering above the city ahead. Curious, he gets up and steps out onto the terrace. Standing at the railings, it's hard to judge the object's distance. Maybe half a mile? Some strange flying thing. It's not moving fast, but it seems to be expanding. No, it's just getting nearer here. What on earth is it? Now it's growing faster. He can even hear it whirring. Six legs come into view beneath its body like those of a giant mosquito. It's a drone! Ever closer it comes until he can see its whirling propellers, one on each mosquito leg. Nervous, he starts to edge back as it approaches the promontory and rises over the end of his garden. He edges back further as it flies to within 10 meters of this terrace, where it hovers over his swimming pool on the level below. One of the mosquito legs curls down and lifts something out from under the belly, then swings this around. It's a camera. Closer still, the drone whirs, adjusting the camera so as to aim straight at him, until it is a mere 2 meters ahead of where he's standing. Sunlight glints off the metal focus rings around the lens, within whose circle he can see the aperture opening, reacting to the reduced light within this new framing of him. Reflected on the lens's smooth surface, he can even see the dark squares of his study windows behind him, and in the center of the lens, his own face looking terrified. The drone executes a jaunty swing from side to side, but keeping him in the camera's sightline as if it were a gun. Then it swoops up and away over Laurel Canyon and is soon lost to sight. Standing there, with his mouth open, Jaymi feels a suspicion arise in him. He couldn't prove it, but he has a nasty sense this was the work of the Dreary Ones. He has state-of-the-art security technology around this whole property, he reassures himself. With a house like this, who wouldn't? But if it is indeed bang dead behind this drone attack, for it was an actual attack, let's be clear, then they won't be interested in robbing him. They'll be seeking to unnerve him, humiliate him, maybe even warn him somehow. Oh, he knows it's them. He can feel it. And now they are in annoying possession of footage that shows him looking terrified and doubtless ridiculous on his own private terrace. There's been frost and enmity in the air between him and that team ever since he left. Dad did not appreciate Jaymi's departure and will have very likely been trying to do him down in the estimations of Jaymi's senior ex-colleagues, notably Kelly, Ashley, Herb and others. Boring, yes, but not so surprising. This, however, has crossed a line. This was a personal attack on him in his own home. What characteristic stupidity of a misjudgment on the part of the Dreary Ones. In light of all that paranoia and concern he'd seen in them, as revealed on the grapevine, a more intelligent course of action would have been to exercise a judicious, hands-off approach towards him, not stage a clumsy provocation. This drone attack, however, was more than a provocation. It was a declaration of war. Okay then, bring it on. They want a war? They've got one.